How long have you had the car?
I've had it 16 years, Mike.
Well, that's a long
16
time,
isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Now, because of this new ULEZ, this ultra-low emission zone that's coming to your area, it means that cars like this are going to cost you a fortune to drive.
Absolutely. And it means every time I want to take it out in the summer, if I want to go out with my wife to buy an ice cream or something, it's going to cost me £12.50 just for that purpose.
Well, it won't be a 99, will it? It'll be a £13.49.
Yes, it will.
Yeah, it'll be too much money. I've got to say, that looks very original underneath there and really in good condition. Have you done any major work under the bonnet?
I've changed the radiator because that had a leak.
It looks amazing, Alan. Really does. Right, I'm very happy underneath here. Let's have a look inside the cockpit, shall we?
Sure thing, yep.
Wow. Alan, I'm going to tell you, inside is lovely, isn't it? There's a roof work.
Yes, it does.
Let's make sure it goes back and forwards. Part of this car's charm, isn't it? Look at that, the electric roof. Make sure it goes all the way back. Well, look, the engine's running. I wouldn't mind getting it out on some of the open roads around here, if that's okay with you.
Sure, take it for a spin.
You don't mind? It's a bit cold, so I'm going to put the roof back on.
Good idea.
I want to try the heater out. All right, I won't be long.
Okay.
Now, it's been years since I've been behind the cockpit of one of these, and they really do feel good inside. You've got a lovely steering wheel, everything's nicely proportioned and well finished. But I hope you can see it's shaking, and that's not the road surface, that's the car. It seems to be running quite roughly at the moment, and not as I would expect it to run, because Saabs, especially with ones with a turbo badge bolted on the side, always give you a thrill ride. If you get to about, 2,000 RPM, put your foot down. They're meant to, snap you into the back of your seat. And this one is doing none of that stuff. I can hear the turbo spooling up, and the turbo gauge is indicating on the dashboard, but the car just doesn't feel right. Also, I've noticed something else. Every time I put my foot down, there's a noise when I put my foot deep into the clutch. And that means that the clutch release bearing or thrust race bearing, whatever you call it, has gone. So that will also have to be addressed. So it all comes down to, price really. Alan is asking £7,500 for the car. I think on a summer's day, this car polished up and driving nice, he might get it, but he's not going to get it from me. I personally think it's worth around £6,000. If I have to give a bit more, I would do for it, but £6,000 would be the target price. Well, let's go back, have a chat with him, see if I can put a deal together. How could I not buy a car like this, a Saab 900 turbo convertible that's got an extra button on the dashboard? No, I mean it. It's got a button that just says extra on the dashboard. I don't know what it does, but it's an extra.
So how was it?
It was like a little step back in time. It's a little bit tired, this car. There's something wrong with the engine in terms of power. The turbo boost is coming in really late. And you must have felt this as well. When you put your foot on the clutch, it's noisy. So it's like the clutch release bearing he's doing. You know, don't get me wrong, I do like the car, but I think where I'd need to be is like £6,000 for it.
A little low. I'd take seven.
7,000?
Yes, please.
I think the problem you've got, Alan, is every time you drive it off your driveway, if I wait long enough, it's going to cost you £12.50, so it will get cheaper, this car. I'll do a deal, but the most I can for it is £6,500. What do you say?
Okay.
Oh, at your end. Top man. Okay. Nice one. I just got and bought myself a Saab 900 Turbo convertible.
That looks amazing. Mate, that is like immaculate.
It's fantastic, isn't it? Wait till you see the inside. Look at the seats and the dashboard.
Wow, I mean, it's like showroom condition.
It is.
And from behind that steering wheel, it's a great experience, isn't it?
Well, it used to be. They give you a thrilling experience, but they did back in 1989 when this one was made.
But now
it's not so good. I remember the first time I got into one of these cars, being a turbo, you got that fizz, you know, the bit down below. Yeah. Well, I've tried that with this, put my foot down, the turbo does spool up eventually, and then when it gets there, the fizz is missing.
And you're sure it's not just sort of 1980s turbo?
No, I just think it's really, really tired. Also, the steering is a little bit, you know, well, I would say woolly. I'll tell you what it is, it's a great looking car, but it's just a bit knackered, a bit like me. Beautiful looking, but actually I'm a bit tired. Plus the fact, I do remember back in the day, this had the option, I do believe, in a three-spoke alloy wheel.
It did, the turbo did, so they didn't go for that.
No, so maybe I'll look into that, and if it was an option and it's correct for this car, I'll add them to the shopping list. What we need to do is to get this car back to the way it was back in the day, and we need to celebrate the Saab-ness of it and the quirks that come with a Saab.
So what do we pay for it?
You're going to like this bit. $6,500.
Wow. In this condition?
In this condition, yeah. Well, put it this way. There's never going to be any more Saabs, is there? So we need to make sure we keep this Saab on the road.
Look, I'm going to enjoy this, mate. That's a good one.
Right, you crack on.
Nice one. I love nothing more than when great engineering meets great design, and that is exactly what Saab are all about. I mean, this car has no flimsy bits of plastic bolted all over it. Everything is here for a reason and has been well thought through. Take this great engine, for example. 16-valve, turbocharged, but packaged in a unique way. Cocked over on an angle to enable them to fit in double wishbone suspension so the car handles better. Love it. However, as Mike said, a few of those bits of well-thought-out engineering at the moment are not quite working as they should. But that's where I come in. Whilst it actually looks okay, I'm going to start by changing the distributor cap, the leads, and a new set of plugs, because this whole lot costs just £30. So for that sort of money, it seems like it's worth doing. Keep our fingers crossed that it fixes the problem. Right, that's it. Hopefully, for just over £30, we might have got to the bottom of our lumpy running issues. Of course, I won't know that until I fire it up and take it out for a spin. So the engine's running smoothly, which means those changes to the ignition have worked. I'm happy that that's fixed the problem. I now want to give it a bit of a blast and see what the performance of this engine's like. That's almost comical. I mean, my goodness, you have to wait for it. I mean, back in the 80s, that's what turbos were like. I mean, the clutch is a little bit less precise than it should be. The steering also, a little bit sloppy and wayward, but it is a 1980s car. I'm pretty sure we can do a lot better than that.
If Mike and I are going to celebrate the brilliant engineering behind this Saab, we need to sharpen it up. One of the things that needs some attention, given that it's done 100,000 miles, which might not seem like a lot, but the car's also more than 30 years old, is the clutch. So that's what we're going to do next. And what they did was they put the engine and gearbox on top of each other. Now that in itself is not necessarily unusual. It's been done many times before. Set up something like that. But here at Saab, what they did to maximise the space and allow that interior bulkhead to move forward, giving us more space for the occupants, they put the clutch and the flywheel assembly on the front end of the engine at the front of the car. That in itself is unusual. That also means that the drive now comes out the front of the engine and they have to then turn that around by 180 degrees to have it come back into the gearbox and then drive the front wheels of the car. They did that through a clever system of gears and chains. That was clever, it was inventive, it was ingenious. And for me, what it means is I can change the clutch without having to put the car up in the air and take the gearbox off. I can do it all by standing at the front end of the car. Okay, so now with my clutch depressed, the next job is to lever out the input shaft, which comes out the front of the engine. I'm just going to pop this bolt into the end of it and then use that together with this giant lever bar to lever it out. Now, they can be quite difficult to pull out and take quite a lot of force, so I'm going to put this little cloth down in front of it just to protect the radiator. Here we go. Yes. There we go. That's out. Radiator's still intact as well. Living out of the way, you can now see that connection that takes the drive coming out the front of the engine through the system of gears and chains down to the gearbox underneath. It's a very clever system. Right, there it is. I think that's the first clutch I've ever taken off while standing in front of the car for the whole job. It's not too bad. Given that this car's done nearly 100,000 miles and is quite old, the clutch, I mean, I've definitely seen worse. It's not too heavily worn. It is glazed, meaning it's gone a little bit shiny, and that's probably due to overheating at some point, but nothing too serious. Over time, particularly with age, these can become brittle and little pieces can start flaking or chipping away, but none of that's happened. It's actually probably got quite a lot more life left in it. However, given that a brand new one, together with all the ancillaries that go with it, cost just £170, it's an absolute no-brainer that I'm going to stick a new one in. And modern technology, modern materials have meant that things like this friction plate, the part that takes up that drive between engine and gearbox, have evolved to the point where it now lasts a lot longer, it's more environmentally friendly to produce, and can cope with a much wider variety in temperature during its operating usage. These springs that were on the old one are there to take up any shock loading when you first pull away in a car, giving you a slightly smoother experience. So together, the whole assembly with its modern materials and technology should mean that when I put this back in the car, we get a much cleaner, sharper driving experience, which is exactly what we want. So all I need to do is throw it back in.
Click here to subscribe.